Okay. We have for you now two very experienced ladies. We have Sylvia Rim, but Ümit will introduce her. So I'll just introduce Ümit, who is a member of the executive committee at the World Council. She's been doing work with gifted children since the 1980s. And so please welcome Ümit.
Now I have the honor of introducing you an American psychologist, Dr. Sylvia Rim, who is a guardian angel for many families who need help. She publishes internationally on parenting, giftedness, creativity, and underachievement. Many books have been authored by Dr. Rim. Two of her books titled How to Parent So Children Will Learn and Why Bright Kids Get Poor Grades are 2008 National Best Books Award winners from USA Book News. Her another book, See Jane Win, is a New York Times bestseller. Dr. Rim is also the co-author of the textbook, Education of the Gifted and Talented Children. She served for many years on the board of directors of the National Association for Gifted Children and received the prestigious N.F. Isaacs, Robert Ross Miller, and Palmarium Awards for her lifetime contributions to gifted children. With enthusiasm, we are ready to hear your presentation.
I am so delighted to be here. I feel my brain is exploding with excitement. I hope I can not put you to sleep even though you've had an exhausting day. But I can't help but remember back to the first conference I ever attended, and it was a very small group from only a small group of countries. And I think we're doing a wonderful job. Suzanne and Tina, thank you so much for all the work you've done. Thank you so much to the association and the mix of cultures, the mix of progress in gifted is very wonderful. Some of you have already heard, who heard me in the pre-conference seminar, you know I started as a parent 1,000 years ago. With four children who actually all turned out to be gifted, and approaching the principal of my oldest daughter's about to go into kindergarten, and she missed the deadline by 2 weeks. And I said, she's reading and has been reading for a year. Is there any way she could enter early? And the principal said, you're pressuring your child. You will really harm her. She can't come to our school. And I was a young kid. I was 22, having my first child, and so unsure of myself. And the tears came to my eyes, and I guess he felt a little sorry for me. And he said, if you send her to a private school, and if they recommend she comes next year, we'll take her. But we didn't have the money to go to a private school. So we went to that private school and I volunteered to help in exchange for tuition. And of course, then she was okay. She went to kindergarten and the next year we went to a different school and so they took her into first grade. And in first grade, a school psychologist, imagine this, evaluated her and said she's normal and she's well adjusted and we have to challenge her. And he knew about gifted and I looked at that man and I said, that's what I want to do when I grow up. And so I became a psychologist. And when I went to school for psychology at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, after a year or two of school psychology, my advisor said, when I asked him if I could specialize in gifted children, he said gifted children didn't need psychologists. And I said I thought they did, and I was going to be one. And so here I am, and I found my wonderful major professor, Gary Davis, who loved creativity and was a wonderful professor to me and mentored me and gave me the opportunities so that I could continue to share with you what I have done in my career, because I was asked to share with you the essence of my lifetime work on underachievement. So from the perspective of a parent, I helped to form the local groups, very much like some of you are doing in your own countries, where you have local groups for the first time, right at the beginning. And when I think of where we've come since then in the US, I am so proud of what we have done in the United States National Association for Gifted Children and all those educators and parents in all the states who came together. We have far to go. We are not entirely successful yet, but we have accomplished a great amount. And then I think about that ugly duckling that was truly a swan, and we saw those beautiful swans dance. And I say, and I remind you that Hans Christian Andersen wasn't thinking only about genetics, because swans can grow up to be ugly swans as well. If parents and educators don't know how to nurture their giftedness. And that's why you're so important. And that's why I need you to understand what a difference you can make as a parent, as an educator, as an advocate. You are very important. Now, we heard some wonderful keynote speakers, and I listened to Dr. Henry Thierry. Is he here today? Not here to hear my compliments. He was wonderful. Did I say his name wrong? Well, whatever it is, he said it right. He said it beautifully. He talked about grit, and he talked about learning to deal with competition, and he talked about saying, why not, why can't we do these things? And he talked about Carol Dweck and a work ethic, and I got really excited because I work with the kids with problems, and they lack all those things until I help their parents and teachers and help them figure out that they can develop grit and they can develop patience and they can develop a work ethic. And that's what it's all about. But because I come to you from the perspective of helping children who do have problems, I don't want you to think that gifted education is all problems. Because what I think is what has happened in the United States with gifted education in the many years that I've worked in gifted education, we've come very, very far. I remember getting on a school board and hearing from the administrator that gifted children weren't mature enough to learn algebra in eighth grade. It wasn't possible. It wasn't possible to ever grade skip or accelerate a child. It wasn't possible to teach them to think creatively. And now we do all of those things, not to the best of our ability, but better all the time. But then, of course, I'm in the trenches. I'm working with those kids all the time. I'm working with their parents and working with their teachers. And if that wasn't enough, 5 years ago, a charter school in Cleveland for gifted children contacted me and said, did I know anyone who would like to work in a charter school for gifted? Did I know a psychologist? And I thought I was still young in spirit. So I took on a new job, and now I work one day a week in a gifted school. So I'm not only in the trenches in the clinic, I'm in the trenches in the school. And so when I heard Dr. Hans Knoop, and I assume he's left, so I can't take him on. If you were here earlier, you heard me ask a question. And you heard me tell him I have some differences. But he told us that when 25% of the children were bored, it meant we were teaching wrong and there was something wrong because children learn through play. Well, children do learn through play. When they're very young, they should play a lot. But when they get into school and they say they're bored, they may not have any idea of why they are bored, and it may have nothing to do with the teaching that's going on. Of course, I want children to be engaged in learning, but who says that gifted children don't have to do some rote work, some exercise for their brain? And who says that everything is intrinsically interesting? We know intrinsic interest is important. We know the emotions are important. But what's wrong with reason? Emotions can lead us astray. If we want to play all the time and we don't believe in a work ethic, we are in huge trouble. And I said to myself, and I quote somebody by the name of William Shakespeare, "There is something rotten in the state of Denmark." I actually love Denmark, but I don't disagree with the man entirely. I think he's just gone too far, and he really has to understand the balance, and many of us have gone too far. We talk about the need to have passion in everything, but let me just tell you, as I go through, I'm going to give you a table of contents, and there it is. That's the different kinds of underachievement that I'm going to touch base on, and of course, I'm supposed to give you practical strategies in an hour as well, and I'll try to touch base on those practical strategies, but I'll probably miss a few. So the first kind of underachiever that really enticed me was called the marching to the beat of a different drummer underachiever, that child who feels very creative, sometimes has a perfectionism of creativity, feels so different that sometimes they're paralyzed by that difference. And I'll talk about that. I'm just going through them quickly and then I'll go back. Then, of course, the over-empowered underachievers, the gifted children who are taught as adults too soon and given too many choices, and the oversensitive underachievers whose parents are typically also oversensitive and therefore think that oversensitivity is an absolute sign of giftedness and want to hold on to oversensitivity. And I had to tell them, sensitivity is wonderful. Oversensitivity is a problem. They will avoid working. The twice exceptional students, those who may have reading disabilities particularly or writing disabilities, attention problems, gender underachievement in females, gender underachievement in males. And then I have to talk about that fashion of passion on all parents trying to bring their children happily engaged all the time. Finally, I can't leave out united parenting and support for schools. And last of all, our legacies. Now, I know you have that all memorized, so I'll do them one at a time, and we'll come back to them. You've probably seen this prototype somewhere. It's a model of what I see as underachieving kids and against a good advance organizer for what I talk about. So the children in the inner circle, typically have a work ethic. They have high expectations for themselves, but not too high, reasonably high. They know how to deal with competition. They love to win, but they deal with losing. They have what we call grit. They hang in there and they stay in there and they keep working. They develop patience, they develop perseverance. And yes, we hope they're passionate about their work some of the time, but we recognize that not necessarily all the time are you passionate about your work. Now, the kids in the inner circle are not there all the time, because when I looked at the successful women in CJ and Wynn, There were times they struggled. They changed majors. They dropped out of college. They came back in. They changed their careers. That happens with women. That happens with men. So in order to be an achiever, you don't have to be there all the time. But those prototypical children on the outside, and I know you can envision them, their typical pattern is avoidance. You know about those defense mechanisms that Sigmund Freud told us about. So they don't work at their hardest. They don't deal well with competition. They only do things when they win. And when they're not absolutely certain they're going to win, they simply avoid getting involved. Now, no one child is like one prototypical child. Any child who is underachieving will have a group of characteristics, but I have them divided in a way that shows the ones at the top much less extreme than the ones at the bottom. The ones at the left, main issue is anxiety and fear and avoidance because they're afraid to make a mistake. And they show symptoms of avoidance, tears and body language that say, help me, feel sorry for me, take care of me. The ones on the right side, and those top ones obviously have very positive names because they're just at the beginning of underachievement, are kids who are highly competitive and insist on dominating, or they don't play the game. So while not every jock jack or social saunderer is going to be an underachiever, they only do things where they're number one, and academic Alice could be the valedictorian of her class if she hasn't dealt with failure, if she hasn't dealt with the appropriate competition, she has not learned the resilience, and she is also at risk. Obviously, the most difficult are that lower group, and there's creative Chris that marching to the beat of a different drummer, the manipulative kids, the entitled kids, the kids who expect to run the show, and as a matter of fact, are a bit narcissistic in the name of autonomy. It's all about them. Not fun. Now, they're not there permanently either. We can pull them in, we can change them. I certainly have changed hundreds of them, not only directly in my clinical work, but just by talking to parents and teachers. You have changed hundreds of them without even recognizing it, just intuitively knowing what you had to do. Because I know teachers and parents make a difference. But I can tell you the kinds of things you can do. I have a pile of practical suggestions that don't work with every child, but I can tell you that if a child has a pattern of underachievement, you can't trust your intuition with them. You have to respond counterintuitively because everyone is responding intuitively and maintaining their underachievement. So for the dependent kids, if you only hear what they say and watch what they do, you will do too much for them. You will help them until they are helpless, and they will not develop the confidence they need to be autonomous learners. And for the dominant kids, they will get you so angry, you will feel like shaking them. You will ground them for life. I had a mother who honestly put her son in prison overnight. She was so angry. And of course, that won't help them at all. They will lose confidence. They will lose opportunities. So counterintuitively, for the dependent children, and I'll go through this in a little more detail, you have to give them that vote of confidence. You have to give them the tools to take small steps independently, and you have to insist on their independence in a very positive, planful way, and you will see them gradually bloom. It will happen, I promise you. And for those dominant kids, stop punishing them and hear where they are and help them to know that you're in an alliance with them, not your enemy, not their enemy, but that you can help them to find where they are going, and they don't always have to be right and at the top. That's not easy. That's not easy. I think of a young man who came to me from New York State all the way to Wisconsin, refused to go to school, and he said the principal wasn't running the school right. And he came to live with his grandmother so I could work with him and get him back in school. It took a whole school year. But when he went back to school, he said someone had changed his principal. And he graduated and became a very successful engineer. So you see, it isn't an easy thing I ask you to do, but it is so, so helpful to so many, and I know we need you to do it. So the creative underachievers, and I'll go through this rather quickly. I married one like this. The first one that I turned around without having any idea of what I was doing. But I met him in college, and he had so many interests and so many things that he loved. But unfortunately, he was on probation. It never occurred to him to do those boring things like studying. And he just followed his interests. But of course, when he became interested in me and I became interested in him, we kind of figured he would have to make a living and maybe he'd have to study. And he did very well and eventually earned his doctorate and became a professor. And we've had a wonderful life together for 58 years because we were married at age 5. So this young man, like many that I see, was being referred to special education for a problem. And his problem was that he wasn't going to do workbooks. And he simply told his teacher that workbooks were not creative enough for him. And not only did he tell his teacher that workbooks weren't creative enough for him, he told his father that workbooks weren't creative enough for him and school wasn't creative enough for him, and his father agreed that school hadn't been creative enough for him either, so this kid was all set to take on the teacher. And of course, when they came down to see me, I did let him know, I did let the father know that he'd better give the different message to the child. And this very, very gifted kid, let me just tell you that he was a little bored. When they were teaching, they put him in the lowest reading group and teaching beginning phonic sounds that he could have taught the class. So he put his little hand in that paste jar and got really excited when he saw that paste come out and said, "That's the theory of displacement that my father taught me about, and that was the referral to special education." But imagine a 5-year-old who knows about the theory of displacement and can read chapter books having to learn beginning phonic sounds. So we got him taken care of, and there is a way to do that. And for those of you who came to my workshop, I talked about the way you get into an alliance, because those are on the dominant side, based on their creativity, and help them to understand that they have to make some trade-offs, that sometimes there are things you have to do that are boring. And I gave them the example of Picasso, his high school work, which is almost photographic, when he had to learn the skills of an artist before he could be out of the box. He has to be in the box. When they're creative writers, I talk about having to learn grammar before you can really be a good writer, and of course they hate that. And oh, the ones who write, I tell them that I am an author, and that gives me a little bit of credibility, and I've written 24 books, and they look, oh, that's pretty good. And then I said, you know what? You have to do about 40 drafts of a book. They're used to writing one draft. And after you get all done and you think you've done the best job you can, an editor comes in there and changes all kinds of things you thought were just exactly right. So helping them to deal with that perfectionism of creativity gets them on board and helps them to understand that creativity is not necessarily easy, but it can be lonely. And it was with Gary Davis that I did the research on Gift and Jiffy, which are creativity inventories, not trying to compete with Torrance, who is my role model and that I love very much and who I remember very much and truly guided me also into the area of creativity. But I was looking for a shortcut an easier way to discover some creative kids who were not necessarily achieving in school as we tried to identify for gifted programming. And of course, some kids don't get it until high school, and they define all their creativity by how they dress. And they come in telling me how different they are. Now, I'd like to go further, but I know my time is short, so I'm going to move beyond that. And if you want to learn more about that, I have to tell you that I have a website for you that has over 100 articles on it. And there's one in there called Marching to the Beat of a Different Drummer that addresses this creative child. There are also other articles that would address some of the other topics, and I'll mention them as I go. So here's the over-empowered kid and the V of love. So even though I think children should play when they're little, I don't think they have to play all the time. As a matter of fact, the developmental concept of raising kids is a very simple concept of a V of love. If you love your children when they're little, little freedom, little power, few responsibilities that go with their small size. And then as they mature, you gradually increase the freedom, increase the choices, increase the power, always matched by increased responsibilities. In that way, they feel gradually empowered, and during that early childhood, they hear what their parents have to say and hear what their teachers have to say, and they really learn a lot. They even learn some boring things like spelling and math facts, which are not necessarily intrinsically interesting. And then, of course, they're ready when they're adults, whenever that is, because sometimes it takes a long time for them to move out of the V of love and be on their own. Now, with gifted children, that's a little tricky. There's a little risk because they sound like little adults very early. They use big words. They sound very, very reasonable. It is easy, very easy, for parents to treat them like adults. It's nice to treat children respectfully, but it is really important to treat them like children. And so with gifted children, a lot of parents give them all the choices. And it's like by the time they're two, they say things like, would you like to take a nap? And a tired two-year-old does what two-year-olds typically do, say no, 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 and the battle is on. For shy children, they say, would you like to take dancing lessons? Would you like to play basketball? Well, the kid says no, and then there's an argument about that. So they give them many choices, thinking they'll be better decision makers. But instead, what they get, the idea is that they should be making all the choices instead of the parents. And they get very angry when parents want to make a decision or teachers want to tell them what to do. And you have some entitled kids who say, I shouldn't have to listen to my parents. I can make my own decision by the time they're 10. And we know they're gifted. And of course, no teacher can teach them just right because they want to do what they want to do and they want to play and they don't want to work and they don't want to deal with hard things because they're afraid that if they deal with hard things, that will show that they're not gifted. You see, they tie into that, if I'm gifted, I'm supposed to know everything. So if you have kids like that, and if you've given them too much power, don't be surprised if you're starting to call them lawyer, because they will argue, and I'll tell you what it feels like. You come home from a hard day of work, and there is a child waiting for you to ask you for something you've already told them at least a dozen times they can't do. But that doesn't stop them. They come at you and you ask and you're a little aggravated because you're a little too tired. So you say no. That does not stop them. They follow you around the room and they give you the reasons. And then you remember you're supposed to be a reasonable parent. So you start reasoning back with them. And you assume that by reason, they will certainly understand. They are planning to win. You've called them lawyers. They know lawyers are supposed to win. And they argue until you do what you promised yourself you would never do. You lose it entirely, in which case, your husband or your wife or your mother comes in from the other room and says, what's wrong with you? And it happens repeatedly, and the child manipulates you against a parent, you against a grandparent, you against a nanny, and you cannot figure out what you're doing wrong. And of course, that entitled child, overempowered child, thinks she or he is supposed to be in charge. And those children come from families that look like this, and you can see by their size who's in charge and who's in control. And the name of the article that went with that is Children Were Meant to Run Our Homes, God Would Have Created Them Bigger. And that, folks, is even if gifted children were intended to run our homes, God would have created them bigger. If you are a parent, and if you have children, would you please tell them that they are gifted because you are gifted, and as a matter of fact, you have a lot more experience? Have a little confidence in yourself. They are so lucky to have you as a parent. Let them know it. And if you have no confidence in yourself, and if you are frustrated about this kid who's running your home, don't tell them. Pretend you're in charge. Can you imagine a teacher going into a classroom and saying, I can't handle the class? They would bury that teacher. And of course, any good teacher knows that, unless they're first-year teachers, and maybe they wouldn't know it then. So then those kids come into the classroom, and they have so much to say, and they're so smart, and they're all good kinds of things, and they've gotten so much attention, because how else did they get that smart? Children who do not have adults who give them a lot of attention, who read to them, who talk to them, are truly at a disadvantage. If parents have gifted children, somebody put time into them. Yes, there's a genetic component, but it's not all genetics. It's environment too. So they have a lot to say, and they're accustomed to all that attention. And pretty soon, they're arguing with the teacher, and they say, I've got a better way to do that math. Or I really hate English grammar, it's a waste of time. And then the teacher gets trapped because, I mean, who could be more rational than a math teacher, right? So the kid says, I've got a better way to do math. And the teacher says, well, you have to show me your work. No, in my better way, you don't have to show your work. You do the whole thing in their head. And the teacher says, you have to show your work, that's part of it. And finally, the teacher says, you do it my way, kid, or you get an F. In which case, the kid now goes home to parents, says, that teacher's going to give me an F, you got to get me out of that classroom. And those are the dominant kids who have too much power. Now let's go to the oversensitive kids. Those oversensitive kids, oh, we see them a lot at our school because they've been oversensitive in other schools. Sometimes they come to my clinic when their child is 5 or 6 years old for testing, and they say to me, I have to be in the room when you test his IQ because he is oversensitive. And I say, guess what? We can't test IQs with parents in the room. You're not allowed to know what the questions are. And of course, if my child is oversensitive, you know, we may never get to test that child. But and what I tell them, we want to cultivate sensitivity. We know that gifted kids can be sensitive and they can be intense, but oversensitivity will get them in the way and we've got to help them. So here's this kid who says, he's new in our school and he says, I can't work in groups, the kids are gonna pick on me. He hasn't even tried. He hasn't even tried. And yet the mother calls up and says, oh, he can't work in groups. The kids are going to pick on him. And, you know, we work with him. And the mother, oh, this mother was wonderful. She understood just what we were trying to do. And she realized what she had done wrong. That child is a different kid today. And it didn't take very long at all. And he learned to get over his oversensitivity. He learned to get along with kids and he did fine. And what about this kid who is so helpless that the mother says, we work in the kitchen because then he doesn't even have to get out of his chair to ask me a question. I'll be right there to help him. And he doesn't get out of the chair. It's mommy, mommy, I need help. And nothing is done on his own. I had a young man with 160 IQ in 12th grade who still had his mother helping him with his homework. And obviously, as an adolescent, he would say, Mom, I can do it on my own. Then he'd start working on it, and he'd get stuck. Mom, I think you need to proof this. It took him a long time to get through college. He did finally graduate, but you know, really, kids have to learn to work independently. They should learn to ask questions if they need help. But what I tell parents is, tell them to try it at least 3 times. And then if they need help, you can help them. But that doesn't mean sitting next to them during the entire time. So a quote from my friend Eleanor Roosevelt, the surest way to make it hard for children is to make it easy for them. And another issue that happens with sensitive kids that somehow Wikipedia has gotten a hold of as very important. Communication about a child between adults, referential speaking, dramatically affects children's behaviors and self-perceptions. You want some practical advice? Be careful of what you say about your children within their hearing. And what you say repeatedly develops their persona. Yes, children have biological differences with which they're born, but 50% of shy children turn that around. And if you take shy out of their vocabulary, it will help a lot. I try it in an elevator with my husband frequently. Here's a little kid in the elevator with a mom, and we're going up and down in some random hotel, and my husband's very friendly, so he waves to the little kid, and the little kid thinks probably stranger danger and goes to mom, and mom says, she's shy, and I say, and of course she hugs mom's legs, and I say, I bet she's really friendly. She looks away from her mom's legs and nods her head. Works every time. So if you take it out of their vocabulary, instead use the words that help her to become what she can be or he can be, pretty soon that persona will change. It's very, very dramatic. I also tried that on Sarah. I experimented a lot on poor Sarah. That's my youngest daughter. So when I was writing this little section in the book, she was upstairs studying. And we were in the kitchen, and I said to my husband, he didn't know that he was part of the experiment, but I said to him, well, Sarah's really studying hard tonight. I knew she could hear me. She came down, oh, Mom, just coming down for a drink of water, going right back up to study. Works every time. So avoiding healthy activities because of anxiety increases fears of these activities. And I tell kids that, and you can tell kids that. I say to them, look, I can't anoint you with self-confidence. Your teacher can't give you self-confidence. You have to earn that yourself. And if, when you're afraid of something, you don't do it, you will never have self-confidence. If you see something you think is hard and you won't try it, you won't have confidence. But if you take a chance, and we can even talk about things that'll help you, and you try it, and you find out you can do something you didn't think you could do before, wow, that's one small step up the ladder of self-confidence. And little at a time, you build that confidence. And don't expect kids to have so much confidence. It's part of their development to gradually build that confidence. If you've got middle school kids or high school kids or even college kids who are struggling with self-confidence, give them some time. They need to be able to learn to build that confidence. It doesn't happen automatically. But for kids who avoid and underachieve, it goes on for a long time, that lack of confidence. So give them a break. Okay, I have a little acrostic here. Use reason to help children and adults overcome anxiety. I'm gonna slip through that because I don't want to miss anything. Then I want to talk about learning disabilities, writing disabilities. I call them pencil anxiety. Lots of boys who hate to write. I think it's related to preschool years when boys are always building and making things with Legos and girls are cutting and pasting and drawing and developing those small muscle skills. But they think they can't write. And then that becomes, as they go later, they think they can't compose writing, the handwriting actually stops them. And it really helps if they can record what they have to say first and get it out so the pencil doesn't get in their way, and then they get better at it. And reading disabilities are very dramatic. I know, I don't know how familiar you are with IQ tests, but some of you are. But this is a child in second grade who tested at 136 when he was in kindergarten and has a reading disability. And when there's a reading disability, you can expect verbal IQs to go down. It's really, really important to have a sense of where he was when he's a young child, because you wouldn't pick up on it. You would think that he was just an average kid and that he wasn't a gifted kid. But it happens every time. And you know what? The reverse also happens. If a kid has a kind of a late start in reading, his verbal IQ may not be gifted. And when he starts to read and loves reading and reading and reading and reading, his IQ goes up 10, 15 points. So IQ is not engraved in stone. It's not just intelligence. It's a combination of intelligence and achievement. And when a child underachieves, IQ scores go down. And when a child has a learning disability, IQ scores go down, and then they disappear as being gifted. So important to deal with both their giftedness and their learning disability. And then, of course, the disadvantage underachievers. They have a great disadvantage regardless of what their economic situation is, if they do not have time with parents or important people. Now, daycare centers obviously are important substitutes, and they can make up for it. But children really, really need that early stimulation. By the age of 8 months, children can already understand when they're being read to. Now, they can't repeat the words, but they're getting the gist of it. And if you read to them early, and if you talk to them much, and if you listen to them talk, it makes a huge difference, which is a reason that every country has to do something about children of disadvantage. We have to provide good daycare for them. We have to provide them with the opportunities that their parents can't provide for them. And we will discover there are more gifted among them than we are discovering now. And finally, but the next issue that I want to share with you is the gender issue, and I'll talk about girls first. Some of you know about my C. Jane Wynn book. I also have a 15-year update of that book called Jane Wins Again. What was a very exciting experience for me to interview a sample of these women 15 years later. And Sheryl Sandberg's message, the blunt truth is that men still run the world. We're doing much, much better compared to when I was a kid. But I think she's right, and that no matter what any of us has, no one has it all. Sheryl Sandberg proclaims that we hold ourselves back by lacking self-confidence and pulling back when we should be leaning in, thus lowering expectations of what we can achieve. We are absolutely still perfectionists. We still want to be told all the time that we're doing a perfect job. And when it's not perfect, we're not willing to, we just give up. We don't stand up and fight for ourselves. And I was thinking about that as our keynoter was here this morning. I was hesitant about raising my hand, but I did. The message that we can't be perfect is very, very important to give to girls. Of course, we've achieved equity in many areas. MDs, we have equity, PhDs, math scores, law degrees, participation in the biological science, but there is a leaky pipeline. There isn't any question about that. For those of you who are familiar with the book that I've co-authored with Gary Davis and Del Siegley, I redo this chapter on women every time we revise it, and it's the chapter that changes most. So the data is improving, but notice that only 3% of CEOs of Fortune 500 companies are women, and that has not improved for many, many years. The places where we've really improved is 27% of school superintendents are now women, and when I first started, we said something like, if you want to be a president of a college, you'd better be a nun, because those were the only women who presided over colleges or were superintendents of schools. And that has, in considering that so many women are teachers, to have 2% women was just amazing. For symphony orchestras, there were almost no women in symphony orchestras until they started blind auditions. And you can see the numbers, 17% in the US Congress is a great improvement, but certainly far from 50-50. And there is subtle unconscious bias in every study we find. So when people, and the evaluators can be both men and women, so the bias is by women as well. They look at two pieces of paper. One has a woman's name, one has a man's name, the same data, and they choose more men for faculty tenure, improvements in salary. And can you believe that even when the data is the same for gifted programming, that more boys are chosen for gifted programming than girls? The exact same data. So we still have a way to go. We have come a long way, but we have a way to go. Now, we have very big boys issues, and there is no question about that. We have had boys issues and underachievement for a long time. Most of the children I see in my clinic who are underachievers are boys. And we certainly in our school have many underachieving boys. They earn worse grades than girls. More boys drop out of high school than girls. Fewer boys graduate college. Fewer boys earn graduate degrees. Boys are more likely to be diagnosed with attention deficit disorder. Boys are more likely to have reading and writing problems. More boys have learning disabilities. And a quote by Alexander Pagnani, gifted male readers lag behind their female counterparts. This literary gender gap manifests in males' reading behaviors, attitudes, and beliefs, and has persisted historically and globally. So we've got work to do there as well. And I talk about the importance of fathers and male role models. We need more dads in our men in our schools. I have to tell you that my first day here, my granddaughter and I went for a bike ride, and I was delighted to see the number of fathers with their children right here in Odessa. Am I saying it right? And it was a pleasure to see. And we have many more fathers involved than used to be, but they're important guys too. Now the one on passion. You probably haven't heard this one, but I have an article on it on my website. I actually have an article on almost every one of these things. I have 100 articles you download free of charge and read or give to teachers or give to parents if you're a teacher. The fashion of passion, it's everywhere. Everybody is talking about passion. Now, who should talk about passion but me? Am I passionate enough for you guys? But truly, what we as adults think of as passion is very different than the way children interpret passion. That's the issue. We do want engagement, but passion is like a too high word. Just like if we set too high expectations for gifted kids, they feel pressured. Passion puts pressure on them. It tells them they have to love everything they're doing all the time. And for kids, what that means is it has to be easy. A quote from Gordon Marino, who's a professor at St. Olaf College. As a counselor, my knee-jerk reaction has always been, what are you most passionate about? Sometimes I've even go into a sermonette about how it's important to distinguish between what we think we're supposed to love and what we really love. But is do what you love, wisdom or malarkey? Folks, you know what the word passion means? It means unbridled deep emotion, not reason. Is that what you're going to put in the hands of imaginative teens? Or could we temper passion with reason? I don't want to make it disappear, but could you help them to understand that their head is for reasoning and that emotions can get you into trouble sometimes? I mean, there are some pretty bad emotions, things like depression and anxiety and suicide and murder and crimes. Those are passions. Those are crimes of passions. So not all passions are good, but you can see that it's a problem. And You wonder why kids keep quitting one thing after another. As soon as it gets hard, they're not passionate about it. What do adolescents mean by passion? Well, I could review video games. You know what boredom means? Boredom means I'm not playing video games. I could be a stand-up comedian. I have to be the best. I want to be famous. I feel different. I want to play basketball from a kid who... I said to him, so do you play basketball? And he said, oh no, I don't play in competition. Too high expectations get kids to be anxious and they don't even enter the arena. Too high expectations when they're not met lead to depression. I remember when I was doing the Jane books, I talked to a young woman who was extraordinarily talented violinist, just extraordinarily talented. And all her life she planned to be a concert violinist, a solo violinist. And she won contests, she practiced hours, she went to music camps, and she always did beautifully. Then she went to the university or the conservatory where she was good enough to be in an orchestra, but she clearly was not going to make it as a solo violinist. Suicidal. She was suicidal and could not even listen to music for the rest of her life. So, you know, if you see the successes only and you don't see the kids in the clinic and the failures and the kids who have a problem, you can get the idea that passion will always lead to success. And sometimes it does, but you do have to help people to temper that passion with reason. I'm looking at that time and I see I'm running out of time. So let me just go through quickly and I'll give you the 5 minutes for questions. If you could write down questions, that will really be helpful in these few minutes on any piece of paper, and then I can answer the questions very quickly. Children are more likely to be achievers if their parents join together to give the same clear and positive message about school effort and expectations. And the corollary of that is children become oppositional if one adult allies with them against a parent or a teacher, making them more powerful than an adult. It is a balancing act, and if you want to raise an oppositional, defiant child, just get them to side with you against their father or their mother, and they will become oppositional and underachieve. And the extent to which you do it, if you do it once in a while, it's no big deal. Everybody does it once in a while. But if you can't be united much of the time, and one parent is the easy way out, your kid is in trouble. In the same way, if you put down teachers to your kid is in trouble. He or she will not learn in school. If you're respectful of each other, you don't have to be the same. You can work out your differences. It's okay. People don't marry each other because they're the same. They marry each other because they make a good unit. Not unusual for an organized person to marry a disorganized person, because it's great. The organized person can help the disorganized person organize. The disorganized person can prevent the organized person from becoming obsessive compulsive. If they respect each other, they learn from each other, it's great for the kids. One time it'll go one way, or one time it'll go the other way, but the parents talk things over quietly and don't let the kids manipulate them. It works that way with talkativeness too. If one person's talkative and the other person's quiet, it's perfect at a party. You know, the talkative person can keep talking, the quiet person doesn't have to deal with social anxiety. So, you know, there's a reason you got together, you needed each other. But if you compromise and respect each other, it really works. It's not always easy to do, but if it's done most of the time, your children will move forward. I change more families that way. It's really, really dramatic. The same thing with teachers. If you put teachers down, that kid is going to be in trouble. Oh, she's getting me now. So thank a teacher. Thank a teacher. It's a good note for me to end on. Just think about the teachers who have made a lot of difference for you. They made a lot of difference for me. My parents didn't have an education in kindergarten. I had Miss Moore in first grade. Miss Warga, then Miss Zanzalary, then Miss Garrettson, then Miss Schubert. She was a wonderful teacher. She made such a difference in my life. And it was my guidance counselor who made the difference in my going to college. You know you know they made a difference for you too. And I'm coming to the end. I'm skipping a whole bunch of things just to say one important thing. Our legacies as educators. 100 years from now, it will not matter what my bank account was, the sort of house I lived in, or the kind of car I drove. But the world may be different because I was important in the life of a child. May you be important in the life of a child, and may your bank accounts also be large. Thank you. Sorry.
For her wonderful talk, and we have 5 minutes to answer your questions.
Got a question, great.
If you have a question, please write it.
Okay, I've got one question right here I can get started on here. I have a question. How is underachievement defined? Well, the general definition is a child not working to his or her abilities in school. There are ways you can compare IQ and achievement tests, but obviously there are problems with that. All you have to do is look at the child's behavior. If they're not studying, if they're not doing their work, if they're not interested, they're underachieving. You know they can achieve more. So it's relatively easy. Another question? Anybody else have a question? Do you want a mic? Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, you could talk. Come on. Well, let's give you a microphone. Is there a microphone we can give her? You know, I have people write it because sometimes I can't hear, but these microphones are very good, so you can talk loud and clear. Talk about Torrance.
You gave some wonderful examples and that parents who were very good parents. What about when the parent is the problem? And I mean, like the parents who over-identify with their child.
Yes.
So it's their anxiety, they're projecting on the child, et cetera, et cetera.
Yes.
And they're not necessarily so willing to.
Yes. Change. You know, and you can imagine that in my school and in my work, I get a certain number of them. The first assumption that I make is that the parent loves the child very much and wants to do the right thing. And then I say with a huff and a puff, I'm really good at helping parents. I know how to fix kids like you, like your child. So I can help you, and I promise you it's going to work. And then I tell them how it will work and what the origin of the problem is, and about 85% of the time, they will listen to me. Now, I have had a few, you know, I heard that story about the school in South Africa and some of the problems they had. We have some of those problems, too. Parents come in ready to get you. I mean, I have some parents who won't let their kids see me, but, you know, but because they're doing the wrong thing, and I'm telling them they're doing the wrong thing. So you're not going to win every time. But if you say it with confidence. Now, that's why I mentioned the handouts. I have a handout on the United Front. You don't have to say one word to them if you think they're either manipulating against a teacher or a parent. Is just give it to them, because it's a short article. And if they read anything, what I do is I project out the scenarios exactly. You know, when I say to a father of a kindergarten child who's too easy on his little girl, and the mom is the one who's made into the ogre, and I say, you know what's going to happen to your daughter? You're going to be the easy way out, you're going to be the easy way out, and she's going to compete with her mother. And then when she gets a little older, you're suddenly going to worry about your daughter because she's running after boys. And so then you're going to set a rule and say, no, for the first time in her life, she's going to hear a no from her dad. And you know what she's going to do when you say no? She's going to think that nobody loves her anymore, and she's going to go from bed to bed to bed. And that gets their attention every time.
Is there any other question? No? Well, I thank you again for your wonderful talk. I think we'll all leave the auditorium with optimism and hope. Because there is Dr. Rim to turn every negative thing into positive. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.